My question concerns foreign NGOs and funding. So you talked about how there's a resource pillage of the global south, but in a lot of countries in the global north, like Western, eco-friendly, liberal democracies like New Zealand and Canada itself, the home of Greenpeace, Greenpeace's activities have been condemned for being too politically intense or too politically engaged. And it's not just the Information Bureau of India that's gone ahead and said that Greenpeace is a threat to national security, but Canada's very own intelligence agency has labeled Greenpeace as a threat in that sense. And even the USA in a congressional audit, it came to light that Greenpeace had accepted $500,000 in funding from ExxonMobil, which is the world's largest producer of oil in that sense. And in light of all of this, and we know that Western nations use NGOs as a foreign policy tool, whether overtly or covertly. So in light of all of this, do you really think that we should allow these NGOs, and they're not small entities, they're very powerful entities with multi-million dollar coffers and a lot of clout. Should we allow these entities with questionable funding and questionable intentions that have been questioned elsewhere to have a larger say or such a large impact on our country's internal affairs? Not to sound nationalistic.
So, yeah.
Do you remember all the questions?
Yeah, I'll go from the last one and then go to her, and then I'll come back to your question because these two are linked somewhere. So on the whole issue of foreign funding and Greenpeace being branded anti-national even in Canada, so you can't accuse us of not being against governments in the northern countries. At least people can't say that's a Western agenda, because we've been campaigning in the US and the European countries against those governments as well. So at least we can be given the benefit of saying that, okay, wherever we are, we oppose corporates and governments who are not pro-environment and pro-people. So So in Canada, why were we branded as anti-national? Our work in Canada has been mostly around saving the Amazon forest, which is the largest rainforest of this world, you know, and we've been working with indigenous communities there in protecting their livelihoods and saving those forests. Unlike in Singrauli, where we are fighting mining, there huge tracts of Amazon forests are being cut down for logging, you know, that's the major threat. So yes, that's what we've done historically. We ran some 16 years of campaign, you know, in saving the Amazon patch, one patch of the Amazon forest with communities there basically. And now, particularly, we have the Canada government said we are anti-national, and they were in the process of putting in a ban for Greenpeace there, because they basically wanted to ban organizations that are working on climate change, and say that anybody who is working on climate change and will talk about reduction of emissions, carbon emissions within the country, will come under the thing of anti-national. Because we what Greenpeace does across the globe is we believe that global carbon emissions cause climate change, and we are against it, and we believe that each country needs to reduce its carbon emission, and if you are going on this path of development with adding more industries, it will keep on adding more you know, carbon emissions. So somewhere you are against the industry even on that whole front basically. So that is one of the reasons why we were, you know, there was this whole move to ban Greenpeace in Canada, which is, of course, Vancouver is where, you know, where we began, you know. The whole thing of foreign funding, you know, it's strange, you know, why we are talking about, you know, how much the total funding of NGOs from foreign sources is amounts to. Does it come even anywhere near what the all the total multinationals of this country, you know, foreign multinationals bring into this country? Does it come anywhere near it? World Bank money, does it come anywhere near? What do you mean to say this small minuscule amount of money that's coming into this country is deciding everything in this country? No, let's be very you know, sure about it. The other thing is, why double standards? That's my major question. When we talk about foreign funding and we you know, shout from the roof, what we don't understand is, you're okay with FDI coming into this country. What you said is that there is an agenda behind the money, right? Yeah, yes, could be. I know that there is an agenda. Greenpeace definitely has an agenda to save this planet. Greenpeace definitely is trying to protect the environment. We are very political, you know. We have agendas. And let me say that very clearly here. Our agenda is to protect the environment. Our agenda is to save forests in this country. Our agenda is to save biodiversity in this country. Our agenda is to stop whaling. Our agenda is to stop oil spills, you know. Our agenda is to stop mining in this country. Our agenda is to stop, not just here, we have an anti-nuclear agenda because it's not safe for people. We are very public about it. Throughout the world, we work in 42 countries and we are very public about our agenda. We are not secretive. We don't have any secretive agenda. This is our agenda. But I really want to know what the agenda, World Bank's agenda is. I really want to know what ADB's agenda is. I really want to know what the agenda of each of these multinational corporations, whether it's Vedanta, POSCO, SR, whoever is coming into this country, Westinghouse, Arriva, what is their agenda? Do you know what their agenda is? I really don't know. I totally agree with you. Money comes with strings attached and conditions attached to it. We are very open about our conditions. We are very open about our agenda. But do corporates come in with that openness? No, they don't. Right? Why do corporates fund elections in this country? We had a high court decision wherein very recently where BJP and Congress was seen accepting money during elections from foreign corporations. The High Court decision is there. Why? So that money is coming with a condition. There is an agenda. What is the agenda? Is it a nationalistic agenda? We don't know what the agenda is, right? Because when I am, if I join all the dots, you know, BJP is being funded by Vedanta, okay? And Vedanta wants a mine in Orissa, displacing communities. Now, who's nationalistic and who's anti-national here? So money definitely comes with conditions. We are not ashamed of the politics that we stand for as Greenpeace. But we will question. The reason why Greenpeace does not take money from corporates or from government is exactly because of this. It's precisely because money comes with conditions. If you take a single rupee from the government, you cannot talk against the government. If you take money from SR, you cannot talk against SR. So money definitely comes with conditions. What I want to know is why there is double standards on foreign funding in this country. NGOs la rahe hain, so it's untouchable. If multinational corporations are bringing it, it's great. It's our development. If World Bank is bringing it, it's great. Our development. But if some NGO which is spending some 1 crore on some tree planting in some part of the country, it's and why the double standards? Let's have one standard for everybody and judge everybody by the same standards, you know. So let's ask those questions the other way around also. And as long as we don't have those answers, I think it will be unfair to only subject NGOs. And I am for transparency and accountability for NGOs. Greenpeace has got impeccable record, you know. The money that we raise is Indian money. Now the whole thing of foreign, whether Greenpeace India is foreign, that's another thing which is linked to your question. Because Greenpeace India is registered in Chennai. We have a registered office in Chennai. Our board is totally Indian. There's no foreign national or anybody foreign in our board. More than 98% of our employees are Indians. Okay. And we are autonomous. We take our decisions. We implement. Yes, we belong to the larger umbrella where we work around climate change. And we are saying that very openly. You know, we want to protect the environment. We want to save forests. Whether it's Amazon, whether it's Indonesia, whether it's Mahan. That's our politics. So, Greenpeace India is not foreign. We raise 74% of our funds from this country. Indians give us 74% of the money. And what we are talking, when we say foreign funding, we are just talking about the rest of the money that again comes into this country because we have a foreign, we are registered under the FCRA Act, which will soon go, of course, because we've been harassed and threatened and bullied just because of this. And I don't think, the idea of the government is to kind of do away with your FCRA, do away with Greenpeace and all of that so that it doesn't have to face these tough questions out there. Because unlike a lot of groups, you know, the difference between people's movements and Greenpeace is that, you know, we're very corporatized. So we'll use social media just like the corporates. We'll use, you know, all those avenues. So they see us as a smart campaigning group, you know, unlike somebody who's just. So when we are fighting on the ground, we are fighting legal battles, we are doing advocacy, we are using social media, you feel threatened. You really feel threatened because we are playing the game, you know, according to your rules. We know how to play that game. And somewhere we are beating you at it. So you are irritated with us. So you keep raising questions of whether you are national, whether you are anti-national, you are foreign funding. So these are some of those questions. Linking with that was the whole incident. Okay, this was not personal. Okay, I'm just trying to say what Greenpeace is and what Greenpeace stands for. Again, you know, the whole thing is about offloading. Why the question that has been thrown at my face in these last 2 months was, why were you going to the UK? Why did you have to go in front of the Britishers and cry about, you know, your woes, and will the Britishers who colonized us come and save us? And there were all kinds of crap things thrown at my face in terms, just because I decided to go and talk before an all-party parliamentarian group, which is called an APPG. Now, we kept on shouting, please go to the British Parliament website and check the status of an APPG. An APPG is an interest group, just like you are an interest group, right? You are, you start your students here. You are an interest group who likes to hold talks on things that concern law and public policy. Just because I came and gave you, we came and we interacted, tomorrow will this group start taking decisions that will affect the National Law School? Are you empowered to do that? Are you?
No, we try to.
You will try to influence. You will try to influence, but are you empowered to take decisions? No. So that's what interest groups are. They're groups that try to influence debates, that try to influence public policy, that try to influence mindsets, right? And it acts as a pressure group, right? That's what an APPG is. There are different kinds of APPGs in the British, you know, registered in under the British Parliament. I was going to talk to the Tribal Affairs APPG, which was headed by a British MP. And there were some 20 people, and we didn't even have too many confirmations from them. But the chair of that group was very, very interested because of the Niyamgiri case and all. He was very interested because he wanted to talk about communities' right to, you know, consent. And he wants to talk about it globally, you know, and how India is pioneering in it, you know. I was wanting to go and tell them that, look what happened in Niyamgiri. Communities decided. That's how in, and then, so, and linking it with Mahan, of course, you know, where we say that, yes, if you did it in Niyamgiri, in Mahan also you have to follow the same process. So we were going there, and why the British group? That's another question. See, SR is registered in the London, it's registered in the UK. Shashi Ruya is Indian, but the company is not registered in India. Let's get our facts very clear. We are not registered in this country. SR is not registered in this country. SR is registered in the UK, in London. And up until mid last year, SR was enlisted in the London Stock Exchange. It was delisted only mid last year. We all know, we are all law students here. We understand what it means to be registered in a country, what it means to be enlisted in the stock exchange of a country. If SR is enlisted in the stock exchange in London, SEBI cannot hold them liable for any violations because they are not registered here. If you are a company registered here under laws of, you know, any violation, whether it's human right or whatever violation you do, whatever ethical, unethical thing you do, you can be held only accountable in your home country where you are registered, right? So I don't understand this whole debate about why were you going to UK. We were going to UK because there's evidence this company is registered there, and the entire shareholders, the investors are out there. I'm very public about it. I want to tell them what the country, what a company registered in your land is coming to my country and doing. You're doing forgery to take away forest land. You're threatening tribals. Just because they're standing up for their rights, you're saying, ghar se ghasit ke gala kaat denge. That's gross human right violations. And I want to tell them that this company registered in your country is not a great company. And, you know, yes, we had a name, was to tell them this. And we were just talking to, and there was no deposition. Because I am saying this very clearly, because I have deposed before a parliamentary standing committee in India when the nuclear liability bill was happening. I have physically gone, taken an appointment, and physically gone and deposed before the parliamentary standing committee on environment and forests in this country. So I know very well what a deposition means. You have to submit a written format, you have to make a presentation. 31 members from all parties were present, and there was a format, and there you go and give evidence. I've done that. So I totally understand what a deposition means. I was not going to depose. I was interacting with an interest group. So I don't understand. as a citizen of this country, in living in this globalized world, I have the right to, you know, express my opinions. And there's enough law in this country that is, which has been supported by Supreme Court judgments like Menaka Gandhi, which says that you have a right to, you know, peacefully propagate your opinion. So what if it's against the ruling party of or ruling government? You have a right to travel abroad and say. And all this is really immaterial, you know, in this world where I can write a blog, that blog can get carried. So will I be held as anti-national because my blog was read by somebody in Canada or UK and my blog was against India and the development paradigm in this country? It's ridiculous, right? I can hold a Skype call. Technology has advanced so much where you so the thing is, you know, in globalized world, you keep talking about the great things about globalization, but the government forgot that there are these things also about globalization, you know. Today you can't say that, you know, okay, you know, I'll kind of insulate India, you know, you can't travel beyond geographical boundaries, it's insulated against all forms of opinion traveling out of this country. No, it's not insulated. It's ridiculous. So the reason I was going there was to interact with this interest group that was APPJ. Now, and it's so funny because I remember when I was going, we didn't even think it was a big affair, you know. So we were like, chalo, yeah, we'll go, it's going to be cold, but still let's go and at least tell them about this, that. And then the next thing you know is like you are on, you know, you are the most talked about thing in the country for 2 years just because you decide, if the government allowed me to travel and go and express my views and come back, nobody in this country would have even known that there was the Mahan campaign, that we've been fighting for 4.5 years. We've been trying to get a forgery FIR registered. We've campaigned for 1.5 years to get a, you know, police station out of the premise of SR. Nobody. The only good thing that happened with offloading personally and organizationally to us is that we got a platform and an opportunity to talk about Mahan and the things that have been happening in Mahan. That's the best thing that happened. Now I keep thinking, you know, it's better we didn't go. There was no point in going, you know. By not going, you've added so much value to the issue. You know, you couldn't have ever added so much value to the issue by going there, I think. No way. Not by an interest group in UK who was just going to listen to you and talk more about Niyamgiri and how India is pioneering on consent of communities. You know, definitely. So yeah, I hope I've answered both these. Yeah. So, and
She actually had the question about how the government of India is increasingly pressurizing the...
Yeah, Greenpeace. Yeah so definitely the government of India is pressurizing Greenpeace much more because what the offloading was just one of the things. Before this, we've been constantly targeted. There have been two IB report leaks last year. And both the IB reports basically said that Greenpeace is reducing the GDP of this country by 3-4%. And we were like, wow, pat yourselves, you know, great work you're doing because you're reducing the GDP of this country. This government came into power with a promise of 1% GDP growth. And we have been reducing 3-4%, nothing like it, you know. We felt so powerful, you know, like we are powerful than the present day government in this country. So that was... And those leaks were, we know why those leaks happened. We know for sure why those leaks happened because IB reports don't get leaked, right? They're supposed to be the intelligence bureau reports. They hand, you know, I've not seen my lookout circular till date. Though it was issued in my name, it's been quashed, it's been set aside. Till date, I've not seen what the lookout circular looks like. Because every document that is given by the IB in court is in a sealed envelope. Because it's like, it's the IB, you know. And no document is supposed to be shared. It's a secret document. But I don't know how two leaks happened. And the government also, top secret, yeah. Top secret. And the documents are very funny. Top secret. And, you know, it's like it's very filmy in that style, you know. Then those leaks happened and those documents were leaked. And it was all basically building a case for Greenpeace. This happened in April and May. These leaks happened. And then in two phases. Wherein we were established as, you know, anti-national interests and all of that. And then in June last year, our funds were frozen. So as I said, 74% of our funds comes from India. The rest comes from Greenpeace International, which is, you know, the umbrella organization, which forms part of all the 42 Greenpeaces that exist in the world. And there's something called the Climate Works Foundation. So we do take money from both of these entities. So the rest of the money that comes through FCRA into this country was set on something called a prior permission. And this is not informed to us. When we went to withdraw money, the bank said, no, you cannot withdraw money. Why? Because your account is blocked. Blocked for what? Oh, we don't know that. Ask the RBI. So we wrote to the RBI. RBI said, we don't know, but your account is blocked. So, you know, funds are blocked, basically. Account was not, funds was blocked. So basically, if you have to get a transfer from Greenpeace International, you have to take a prior permission. The government will not give you the prior permission. So that was the modus operandi. So this happened, and then we wrote to MHA. We are trying to find out, like, from various people. Oh, what? Why are you doing this? Why? Nobody is talking to us about anything. Then we filed a legal challenge in the Delhi High Court, saying, but what is this happening? So then the government files, you know, a big affidavit saying, oh, you know, Greenpeace is anti-national, and their funds that are coming from the foreign countries is being used in this country to further interests, you know, which is foreign agenda and this country and all kinds of things. You know, we are stopping development and 3% GDP growth and all of that. And then that case happened, and in 20th of Jan this year, we won that case. The courts basically said that there is no evidence on record to prove that they are anti-national. It's a sweeping argument. Like, who's anti-national based on what, you know? And they basically said, oh, there's FCRA violation and this and that. But they didn't have any evidence to prove all of this. And because they didn't have any evidence to prove it, the court basically said, no, their funds have to be opened up. And since Jan, we've been able to access Greenpeace International funds in this country, and we've been using it. Okay. And then came the offloading. So the thing is, this is a calculated step. You know, you're being targeted, constantly being harassed, you're constantly being threatened, because there's a whole element, you know, the IB is a scary word in this country, you know. It's a body that's created under, there's no statute. It's an extra constitutional body, immense powers. They are not RTI-able. You can't get any information out of the RTI. It's not governed by the RTI. So, you know, you have this ghost of a body, very, very powerful under MHA, not created under any statute, lots of power. You can go and snoop on anybody. You can check Priya's mail. You can tap her phones. You can get hold of all of Greenpeace's bank accounts, their transaction details, and all kinds of things. And the kind of arguments that have come in favor was that, oh, why does Greenpeace have encryption? You know, encryption. We've said 74% of our money comes from people in this country, individuals who've trusted us enough to give a part of their salary to us. They've trusted us enough to give their bank details to us, you know, which includes their credit card numbers. We have a database to protect. Yes, we have encryptions. Yes, we bring in cyber activists, you know, who protect our computers and our database. But that's our responsibility, right? If you've trusted me and you've given me your bank account details, I have to protect it. I can't put it in the public space for anybody to come and hack it and use it to their own advantage, can I? So as a responsible organization, yes, I will put in place systems that will not allow people to hack into our systems. And so what's wrong about it? What's so great about it? We know that all corporates have all these systems in place. We don't question again. There are no standards. Like, you have a different set of norms for corporates in this country, and you have a different set of norms for us. And we've been giving explanations for each of these things. Why, even questions like, why do you have an encryption? This is why we have an encryption. Why? So we are out there. We are totally out there. You can ask us questions. There's no secrets. We don't have any secrets to hide, because we're very blunt and open in our fight. We challenge the government, and we believe in doing it, and we're very proud that we are doing it. So that's how Greenpeace and this whole issue is, and Greenpeace will continue to be targeted, I believe. All FCRAs are coming up for renewable in 2015 June. Let's see if Greenpeace's FCRA will be renewed. We already have we have tax notices with retrospective effect being served on us from 2009. So there's all kinds, like there's MHA raid, they come and they sit in your office for 1 week, pull out this document, 10 years ago documents, why was this contract made? So, you know, like, that's harassment, and that's happening, and it'll continue. But all I want to say is that Greenpeace is not scared of these things, you know. we've done this for years and we'll continue to do it. You know, as the big saying goes, you know, when we had this Rainbow Warrior ship, you know, that was bombed when there was nuclear testing happening off the French shores, and the Rainbow Warrior ship had gone to intercept and stop that nuclear testing underwater and bear witness to that whole activity. The French government bombed the ship, in which the captain was killed also. Yeah, and the photographer was killed. And there was this ship was called Rainbow Warrior, and there is a story that runs in Greenpeace, which says that the then international ED, executive director of Greenpeace, was called up, and they said, "Oh, the Rainbow Warrior has been bombed, and what do you have to say?" And she said, "You cannot sink a rainbow." So we had the next Rainbow Warrior. And Greenpeace is like that. It's just like that rainbow, which cannot be sunk. You know, we may fight, we may get banned, we may get beaten, all that will happen, but we don't stop fighting. We hold very close to ourselves the values that we hold, and we continue to fight for them. So way forward, I don't know what we'll do. We kind of cross each bridge as we come to it, because we also don't know what the bridges are and how many are there. But one thing we definitely know as an organization is, because we had a choice not to fight the government, you know, when the IB reports were there, we filed the case. When the offloading happened, we filed the case. So we had a choice not to fight. We had a choice to negotiate and try and be a little quiet and see if there was a backdoor mechanism of, you know, trying to exist and exist on somebody else's terms. We didn't go that route. We said, no, we've not done anything wrong. We'll fight it out. And we will continue to be that, because that's the skin of Greenpeace, you know. Greenpeace, whatever said and done, Greenpeace doesn't lose that color in it. Yeah. And coming back to his question.
So you had two questions, sir. One was alien will and the democratic deficit, your sense of democratic politics from the regions that you respond to.
Yeah.
And second is the growing trend of state abdicating responsibilities on a mass scale. Do you think it's irreversible, and your comments?
Yeah, so this whole thing of the growing trend, I totally agree with you, because in other countries where social security was something that, you see that in each of the Western countries, the so-called developed countries, also you see the state is actually pulling down or reducing their investment or their stake in social security, basically. So definitely governments world over are trying to say that welfare is not the government's responsibility. Anybody can come and take over welfare, or maybe if there is nobody coming to take it over, there can be a vacuum or whatever. But states are definitely moving back on the whole concept of welfare state is going back. And in some countries, like at least the third world developing countries, you find corporates coming and showing you then that dream of, oh, you know what? What if the state has moved out? I'll open the hospital, I'll bring in the school, and I'll bring development. So I'll bring in social security into this country. So that definitely is happening. I totally agree with you. In terms of democratic representation of people in Mahan, we had we had elections in Mahan, you know, and because Greenpeace has a political stand, you know, but we are not part of any, we are an apolitical organization. We don't link with any particular political group or stand by or nor accept donations from political groups. We hold those freedoms very close to our values. And so we, of course, though Mahan Sangharsh Samiti, you know, there were individuals who were in the fight who wanted to stand for elections, we were very clear that we don't want to get involved in it, and neither was Mahan Sangharsh Samiti as a Sangathan ready to get involved in elections, you know. But the interesting thing was, all the people who won in Mahan stood individually. There was nothing to do with either Mahan Sangharsh Samiti or Greenpeace. But what's interesting is all the people who won elections, panchayat elections in Mahan, the people who had stood up for forests there. As opposed to, so somewhere I think, you know, there is that decentralization and the democratization of the process. But if you look at another level, the local MLA is BJP. The center is ruled, state is ruled by BJP, the center is ruled by BJP, the MPs also, but they come with company officials. So you've got votes from these villages, you know, this is your constituency, you stand up for this constituency, you speak for the rights of communities in this constituency, yet when they came for a meeting, people in Mahan Sangharsh Samiti asked them that aap vidhayak ban ke aaye hain, to ye company walon ko kyun leke aaye hain? Because they were surrounded by Hindalco and SR officials when they came to meet Mahan Sangharsh Samiti. And the first thing they said was, Greenpeace bahar jaiye, hum apne logon se baat karenge. So the apne log came and they said, but you know, like, what is it that you are doing for this region? So somewhere, Mahan Sangharsh Samiti has got supporters of AAP. Mahan Sangharsh Samiti has got supporters of BJP, people who voted for BJP. It has also got people who voted for the left and people who voted for Congress. But Mahan Sangharsh Samiti is very, very clear. All that, theek hai, you know, you can vote for what you want, that's a different politics altogether. But it, when it comes to their forests, their rights, the politics is only for us. The politics is not Congress, the politics is not BJP, the politics is not AAP, the politics is not left. The politics is Hamara Jungle, Hamara Adhikar. And we are very clear about that. And the fight is very clear about that. It's a very, you know, it's a very strange situation. That's the reason why you find that the tribal affairs minister stands up against dilution in this country. Because he comes from the land of POSCO. You know, his constituency is where the POSCO fight is. So, there are people who are very, very connected, you know, democratically. They feel very, you know, responsible as elected representatives. I've known so many elected representatives who've stood up against their own political parties because they've said that I come from this constituency and people in my constituency want this or don't want this. And I stand with the people who elected me. I don't stand with you. I'm willing to give up my place. I've known political people who've been elected. I know one person who got elected. He resigned and he stood by himself, you know, and he won because he stood with the people. So, but not everybody does that. Yes, I agree, but it's a very, what do you call, I don't have a straight answer for it, but at least in Mahan we know that the politics of the region for now is forest and saving the forest. So whoever comes. So, and the other thing is, people in the fight are also very conscious of not politicizing the fight. They are very conscious. So, for example, somebody who's gone to jail for the fight will be given a big welcome, whereas a local BJP neta or a Congress neta will not be given that welcome. Because for the fight, Akshay is a big hero, because they keep saying, you came from the city and you got arrested for us and you got beaten up by the police for us. You did all this for us. So, they're willing to see Akshay as a hero, as opposed to an MP or an MLA who will come to talk to them. They are like, but what do you have to, you tell us what you will do for the forest. And if you can't do anything for the forest, goodbye. So, I think that ways, you know, people are very political. They know what to, you know, where to stand, because they've been fooled enough. You know, that region has seen displacement and mining for 30 years. So, they know what to stand by. They know that otherwise they'll just become another bunch of people who are displaced with no rights, holding these agreements on paper like Amravati did and continuing to say that mujhe pension do, mujhe bhatta, berozgari bhatta do, give me unemployment allowance, and nobody will even bother to come and give you anything. So they understand that. I don't know whether I have answered your question.
Okay, I just want to say one thing on here. So, आप लोगों को पता लगा अभी तक ग्रीनपीस कैसे काम करती है, व्हाट वाज द होल थिंग? सो नाउ आप लोगों ने बोला हम आए, ठीक है. सो एक चीज जो हमारा डिमांड है, राइट, एज ऑल ऑफ यू आर या आस्क, या जो हमारा आस्क है, राइट. सो ऑल ऑफ योर स्टूडेंट्स, राइट, सो आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू आस्क योर मॉनेटरी सपोर्ट, राइट. व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू आस्क, ग्रीनपीस जैसे काम करता है, इसमें बहुत सारे यंगस्टर्स हैं, right, and we need lots of volunteers, right. Why? Because abhi jaisa unhone pucha ki aage kya hone wala hai, aage yahi hone wala hai ki might be we will not have a office also, right. So we need people like you, right, jo voice ban sake, right, jo kam se kam aa sake, apna time de sake, aur kam se kam ek bar Mahan aa sake, right. Yahan par abhi aapne sirf ek video dekha ki Mahan kya hai, theek hai, lekin Mahan actually kya hai. लास्ट ईयर हम लोगों ने एक कैंप ऑर्गेनाइज किया था, महुआ कैंप, जो महुआ गांव वाले बीन रहे थे, राइट, दैट वाज अ येलो कलर फ्लावर, जैसे महुआ, राइट. तो 25 से 30 लोग स्टूडेंट्स एक्चुअली ऑल फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर इंडिया, सम लॉ स्टूडेंट्स, मीडिया पीपल फ्रॉम टेस एवरीवेयर, फ्रॉम एवरीवेयर, दे केम एंड दे स्टेड देयर फॉर 20 डेज. दे पिक महुआ, राइट. उन लोगों ने 3 क्विंटल महुआ पिछले साल इकट्ठा किया था और गांव वालों ने बोला था कि हम आपको पैसे तो नहीं दे सकते हैं महासंघर्ष समिति को, वो मतलब कांट गिव अ बिग अमाउंट. दे एवरी जब भी हमारा मीटिंग होता था, गिव अ स्मॉल स्मॉल अमाउंट, राइट. लेकिन अगर आप चाहें तो आप हमारी खेत, हमारे महुआ के पेड़ पे महुआ महुआ बीन सकते हैं. तो हमने बोला हम तो 5 लोग हैं, हम कितना महुआ बीनेंगे. तो हम लोगों ने एक लोगों से पूछा, 25-30 लोग वहाँ पर आए. सो दे हैव कलेक्टेड 3 क्विंटल महुआ और अभी हम लोगों ने 11 तारीख को उसको बेचा है. सो वी गॉट 8,500 रुपीज फ्रॉम वॉट एवर जितना भी महुआ उससे हुआ था. सो आई एम नॉट आस्किंग यू फॉर कम एंड पिक महुआ, बट इफ यू वॉन्ट यू कैन कम, राइट. लेकिन कम से कम अपना कुछ समय आप लोग दीजिए जिससे आपको एक कनेक्ट हो सके एंड देन उसके बाद हम लोग एक बार बात कर सके कि डेवलपमेंट क्या है. क्योंकि मैं एक चीज़ अपने बारे में बताना चाहता हूँ कि 4 से 5 साल पहले आई वॉज अ मैनेजमेंट स्टूडेंट. ओके, सो यू नो द ऑल द मनी एंड ऑल द प्रॉफिट्स आई मेरे भी कई ड्रीम्स थे, राइट, जैसे एक यंगस्टर्स के होते हैं, राइट. मेरी भी डेवलपमेंट की परिभाषा बहुत अलग थी महान में घुसने से पहले, राइट. लेकिन महान हैव चेंज्ड मी अ लॉट. आई वॉज हैड ए नाउ माई टेल, राइट. सो तब समझ में आता है कि हम जब डेवलपमेंट की बात करते हैं तो क्या डेवलपमेंट की बात करते हैं और डेवलपमेंट किसके लिए होना चाहिए, राइट. सो आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू टॉक मोर, बट या ट्राई टू फाइंड अ वेज टू कनेक्ट ग्रीन पीस एंड वी हैव अ महान संघर्ष समिति पेज ऑल्सो, राइट. गो ऑन फेसबुक एंड प्लीज शेयर like
it is moderated by him, by the way.
So yeah, because we need lots of voices and you know you are a law student, if you come and help us and we need your help, we seriously need your help. Yeah, thanks a lot. Thank you.
thank you I think we should end on a note that we are staring at a very impoverished definition of national security, which does not involve preservation of one's natural resources. So a really perverted sense of national security that you're staring at. When the engines of when globalization is used by someone else, we tend to get very uncomfortable. I mean, that's quite evident from the kind of allegations being faced by Greenpeace. But thank you so much for coming and talking to us. On behalf of Public Law and Policy Discussion Group, I would love to present you three with mementos of our appreciation. Thank you.
Well, you've given me a copy of the Constitution. And that's a very handy one for that matter, which I can keep showing the SP and the collector and pulling out and, you know.